looks like everybody's busy with the Teacher's Day celebration. For me, it's the day of celebrating Teacher's Day. Most importantly, the topic of the seminar lecture today is something very dear to us, many of us, some of my colleagues will join. For various reasons, we try to look for new frontiers within sociology, social anthropology, and those new frontiers will be more visible if we engage with some of those materials which are otherwise considered not so important or put in margin or are given some kind of sub-disciplinary areas. And so that way it's important. Secondly, listening to Professor Vishwanathan is itself a great treat. We have grown up as students listening to her in the past. There were teachers for whom one felt like saying Happy Teacher's Day, and she was one of them. And it's a great coincidence that today is Teacher's Day and we are getting to listen to you. There are several works she has produced. I'm not going to give you the whole list. I think you can very easily access the list online on JU website or even otherwise. Google is the best search engine to find the kind of works a scholar has produced. I would sincerely advise you to take a look at some of her works. This is, in my knowledge too, this was a little less visited by some of us, this essay you did. And that way, it's a great discovery for me that Professor Vishwanathan, this essay has to be heard. And I've also requested her if this can be revised and written for our journal in some other form. Some of our young scholars are also editorial assistants with the journal, so that therefore I'm informing them. So, with this very humble and little introduction, I request Professor Vishwanathan to please get up.
Technical paper, and I just have to take a few minutes to describe why I wrote it. Shankar Bharwa used to hold an internet and e-creativity conference a decade ago, and he, I didn't know him, he wrote to me passing. Then I went to three of these conferences, and the fourth one I said, I would like to be there. So he said that then you must write a paper. So I was quite startled. I was interested in the net, as you can imagine, all of our centers where we are. We found it an extremely liberating space. And so I wrote this paper for that conference in 2009. So at the start, I actually wrote to people I didn't know. I was just explaining to Vic Parker that when I would surf the net, I would find somebody who was focused on a particular aspect which interested me, and then I would write them and they would do that. So this paper is essentially about how we think about the 17th century and how we think about ways in which we live our own life. So H.G. Ponsbaker asked, why do we not see the substitution of the attendance at jazz concerts as substitutable form of sacred venues for the playing of music? Is there not a homology between the great churches of medievalism and the presence of the oratorical and musical forms of contemporary musicians who have a whole opening up? A new forum of shared music that has appeared is that of music available on the World Wide Web for sale or for free download. John Sayle's website, which plays recorded music from the 14th to 17th century, is an example of this whole work. He is particularly interested in the work of John Rowland, whose work he just heard, who is a contemporary of Shakespeare. So when I looked on the web for Shakespeare music, that was the topic I chose for myself, I found that Shakespeare has not written songs to be played to music. And in fact, it's only recently that there's been a reworking of this suggestion that the sonnets were not set to music. The MP3 downloadings are free of charge, and Sayle's only request is that there should be communion and interaction between fellow enthusiasts and musicians. So many of us, when we can't find answer to a focused question, we start looking in parallel directions. So comparative sociology is a great way by which we negotiate with our own queries. So Professor Susan Iodine, a reputed teacher of Renaissance music, converges the philosophy of sharing both the playing as well as inciting this music for students and creating archives of published music. It is interesting that her note to John Sayles, forwarded to me by Sayles in answer to a request, she says that Shakespeare's sonnets have not been set to music because it was possibly not a genre that was meant to be sung. However, pop musicians like Rufus Wainwright, Gavin Bryars, and David Gilmour have adapted the sonnets to music. Shakespeare's Sonnet 18 was adapted by David Gilmour of Pink Floyd fame. When Love Speaks is a recording by Rufus Wainwright and Annie Lennox and Brian Ferry. The website of London's Royal Academy of Dramatic Art has further information, as does Shakespeare Geek and Creative Commons license, BBC Radio and the Live Record, where youth music is highlighted. John Dolan's first book of songs or airs was published in 1597 and was the most reprinted music book of that time. It would not be surprising the sonnets approximated a familiar enough genre of Dolan and Watt and others, whose music is still of great interest to the film and theatre world. And within the context of information sharing in the family, music and words could be well adapted. At Iowa, Professor Robert Henley, expressing the sense of the common ground of academia's world community, appeared at a writer's workshop which we attended in Shimla and Delhi. So this was the Australia Pacific Writers Workshop in October 2008, and both Henley and I had been requisitioned by the IIT, who had sponsored this event, to be part of a teaching group where we work with writers, either for purposes of objective recording or documentary dissemination, or for the purposes of fiction writing. So one evening, he sang Full Fathoms Five to fellow participants after work hours. He said his sister had taught him the song when he was a young child and that she had been a stage actress before her death. It is these motives of family life which draw our attention to the great role of autobiography in the dissemination of information and the nature of social constructions of the relevance of this information. For a long time in India, almost two decades, Shakespeare studies had been anathematized in Delhi as being a consequence of Macaulayism. This had an impact on the teaching of Shakespeare in the undergraduate departments, as more emphasis was being placed on functional grammar. However, the numerous Shakespeare productions in Indian languages continue to fire interest in the subject, the best known perhaps being the Kathakali Shakespeare plays, which were presented on stage in Delhi by performers from the Kathakali Centre and Kuthal Institution. They used medieval music from Kerala, employing the Chandakar drummers to do the test, and wonderful cadences of language, since Shakespeare translated very well into Malayalam. Whether we think of Berlioz's Romeo and Juliet, which is thought to be one of the most powerful forms of international construction, or Kathakali accompaniments, we are dealing with the translatability of Shakespeare into what we may call the common plateau of the human condition, and that is what all great art or great technique tries to do. As Marcel Mauss would argue, there is a magic to this, and the volatility of this magic is not just to transport us, but to transform the very nature of the reality that we know. The great German writer of the 1930s, Norbert Elias, when describing what culture is, spoke of how Shakespeare was the equalizer of culture and hierarchy, so that plebs and aristocrats shared the Shakespearean stage and the circle of the audience, where so much of the vitality of medieval dialogue was set up, to recognize oneself in the plays. However, in Germany, Shakespeare was essentially an aristocrat's domain. Shakespeare was a poet for whom a memorial was created for his corner in Westminster Abbey, so it is taken for granted by the world in general that the sonnets have a musical or lyrical quality to them. Professor Susan Ireland writes to John Sayles in an answer to a query which I have put to him. All of them are perfect strangers. I'm very grateful for their intellectual commitment. So Ireland writes, Shakespeare's sonnets have not been set to music that I'm aware of. Somebody may have made a contemporary setting using their own music and his verse, but there is nothing original, as they were not meant to be sung. There are many texts from his plays the scholars speculate had been sung. but the music has been lost. Do you remember that book, Music Without Truth, T. Shakespeare? That has what I think are all of the extant songs from the plays. I think I might have an old Xerox of it somewhere. Some composers also made arrangements of the better known tunes for Gamba solo as well. This isn't very helpful, but it's my best effort for now. The answer came in response to my letter to Mr. Sayles. Dear Mr. Sayles, I chanced upon your website a couple of weeks ago as I was researching a paper on Shakespeare and the sonnets and heard your absolutely wonderful renderings of both. Thanks so much for making the music available to all of us. I will be presenting your work at a conference which is on internet and pedagogy. The paper is on sonnets and music. Do you know of anyone who works with free MP3 download as you do, specifically for Shakespeare sonnets? That would help. Anyway, all research is about distractions, and Roland turns out to be someone who is hugely popular. I never heard of him. And so I'm setting up a parallel space for him in my paper, using your website and the information in the music you play, so that others come to know of your work. The conference is the fourth annual Carnival of E-Creator, his director, Shankar Parva. In her book, Meaning in Music, Rashmi Goswami argues that, to quote, music expresses emotion, carries with it a life force, it must be understood as a whole. Emotion is a hermeneutic mesh. In a raga, the music embeds meaning within itself. A text is realized, she writes, calling Kodama, that when it is understood, music must be heard. Balance is sought between the subjective and objective, the constant and the variable, the structure and the unstructured. What is required to complete the harmonic circle, as I read it, is the internal, purely musical coherence, fittingness and the appropriateness of musical work. You may see these ideas at work in Francis Yates' well-known book on the theatre in Renaissance for the theatre of the world. Robert Flood was a contemporary of John Dee, archivist and astronomer to the court of Queen Elizabeth I, but he was much younger. Both were influenced by Paracelsus. In Flood's writing, the theme takes a musical form and is worked out in terms of musical proportion. The proportions of a microcosm and their relation to those of a macrocosm, or the musica humana, the musica mundane, are the foundation ideas of Flood's Volamina's work. The Renaissance philosopher to whom he was perhaps most indebted to was Francesco Giorgi, whose Harmonia Mundi is on similar lines to Flood's work. Giorgi had related musical proportion to architectural proportion by using ritual man as a symbol of the divine and human proportions. So I take this from Francis Yates. The image of ritual man was certainly also present in Flood's mind. The publication of Macrocosm and Microcosm took many years, but they arrived in quick succession in 1617, 1618, and 1619. His treatise on music was written between 1592 and 1600. In the late 16th and 17th centuries, St. John's College was a center for the High Church revival, led by William Lord, who was contemporary with Flood at St. John's. An important aspect of this revival was the introduction, or rather reintroduction, of music into the liturgy. Lord was keen on the use of organs and his friend Sir William Paddy, a great luminary of St. John's and deeply interested in music, presented an organ to the college. Clearly, church music, court music and love poems were all interlaced in what Joan Kelly describes as an interesting union during this period of divine love and court poetry, and the abstract and transcendent liaisons which often had corporate aspects as well. So, the study of medievalism in order for us to understand the way in which we are living our own lives is probably the point that I wish to make. That the parallels that we draw in terms of how we look at the political and cultural questions which define our own preoccupation today, that's what informs this paper. So Alan Sinfield in his Shakespeare, Authority, Sexuality, Poland, Unfinished Business and Cultural Materialism, argues that Shakespeare's sonnets are popularly believed to be directed to the Earl of Southampton. The sonnets have no addressee. The boy, that's in quotes, appears to be encouraged to marry and to procreate. So sonnets need not actually be saying anything on Shakespeare's own sexual orientations. He certainly used the theatre and writing parts for boys, I suppose use the curtain or draw the curtains. Something which we must accept, and although we write about dams and about displacement and about our own wasteful, we're still very, very dependent on electricity in our urban farmers. So, as I was saying, so the sonnets have no addressing, the boy appears to be encouraged to marry and to procreate. Sonnets need not actually be saying anything about Shakespeare's own sexual orientations. He certainly used the theatre and writing parts for boys to play with nuanced roles. Does the boy encroach on the poet's woman love as a treacherous friend? Is there a liaison? The options Sinfield engagingly writes are yes, no, or transcended as ideas of ideas. Art definitely transcends and is passed down generation to generation, either through print or oral traditions or through mechanisms of access which may or may not be realized. What is faith in it? The poet must believe in the integrity of his own art, of his/her own art. Sexual passion, however, is more intense than transcendence. What is the place of the minion? Is it delight and self-abnegation? A secret love cannot be dislodged by public pressure, and that is the essence of the sonnets, which, like any art form, can be read free of biography and without the anchorage of the creator's own sensibility. John Rowland, whose first book of songs or airs was published in 1597, was a contemporary of Shakespeare. The website is Encarta. His music, written for the lute and still sung by radio and stage artists, approximates the idea that religious and love music approximated a common form. This idea is also apparent in the sonnets, which deal with spiritual and material pleasures, seasons, activities, and objects of desire draw from a common root. The Reformation and the varieties of dialogue that are set up amongst individuals, of whom musicians and poets are the most celebrated, provided a backdrop to how we think of patronage in 16th and 17th century England. John Doran's Latinate is available in a rendering on BBC Radio on the website of Lyricord, where the performances of Russell Oberlin and Joseph Iodum are still remembered. A reviewer on the website of Sonnets set to music called Pippi, writing on Stephen Wood's edition of the Sonnets, writes, open quotes, "One reason that Elizabeth's lyrics are so powerful and memorable is that we were compressed in an age when poetry was still linked closely to music. Elizabethans were often competent musicians, and many of their poems were true lyrics or songs. Often their poems were set to music, and all were probably composed while the gentle plucking of a lute or some such instrument was running somewhere through the back of the poet's mind." Close quote. Similarly, British Theatre Guide website advertises Nothing Like the Sun, the Sonnet Project. This is Gavin Bryer's 40-minute piece based on 7 of Shakespeare's sonnets. There is another reference in Shakespeare Heath, this is when last week's sonnet set to music. Rufus Wainwright, Annie Lennox, Ralph Fiennes, Kenneth Branagh, late John Deakin, and the prophet's book, London Royal Academy of Dramatic Art. The website A Way to Teach uses sonnets as teaching practice in schools and theatre practice employed to enact the sonnet. So who was the dark lady of the sonnets? No one knows. She might have been a good player in a tavern when Shakespeare spent much of his time away from home. So Badu has put 2 pictures by Caravaggio, which was separately painted, which we look at later. So Germaine Greer, Shakespeare's wife, published in 2007, argues that given there were plagues and fires, it would need a competent woman to run the home and bring up 3 children past these catastrophes. So you have to remember there was a great fire, there was a great plague. Today in Kerala we see exactly the space where which people look to define and redefine their lives and what they will do with them. So in some senses, these catastrophes accompany us as humans wherever we may be. Anne Hathaway would have to be someone who could cook, garden, weed, and yes, maybe sell meat to augment the income of a household where death was not unknown. That Shakespeare was away for long years but came back whenever children were to be propagated or property bought is a statement in itself. Why Shakespeare was so popular is explained by Frank Kermode in The Age of Shakespeare. So, to paraphrase, with Henry VIII, there was a tremendous surge in the writing of plays. The commercial development of drama was one more sign that the world as regulated by liturgy was being supplanted by a world more concerned with capital and labor, a world in which time itself had a different quality. The churches were stripped, communion tables replacing them, books replaced the old images, wall paintings, stained glass, decorated altars. So to quote Kermode, Shakespeare was then living a presumably bachelor life in Bishopsgate, not too far from the theater. Of his private life, very little is known, though the sonnets fuel a great variety of conjectures. We can harmlessly suppose that in these years, when so much of his time was devoted to the fortunes of the English monarchy, Shakespeare was as aware as any other intelligent person of the uneasy state of the kingdom. The queen old and difficult, the succession still in question, Essex increasingly dangerous. The common ideas of those times were well described by Francis Yates, as I have previously argued. Let us now look at Germaine Greer's reading of the biographical details of Shakespeare's life. The book is called Shakespeare's Wife. She uses parish records, local histories, and all the archives of Shakespeare museums to recover for us the sense of the everyday. Warwick and Henry Street both appear in the space of history and drama, of legends and old accounts. For anyone who has wondered what Anne Hathaway did at home while Shakespeare was writing and producing plays, here is a probable history. We see that work in housewifery was safe places for a woman bringing up children. Through the chronicle of plague and deaths, we see how family, neighborhood, friendship ties, and peasant economy allows an independent woman to survive the greatest odds. Local economies depend on the work of women, and Greer gives us a lifetime's obsession, moving us in a sure-footed manner away from the idea that here was a woman unloved. She uses the text of the river of work and property and prosperity to negotiate with the history of the petty bourgeois, where being the daughter-in-law of a glover and someone who was in politics would lead to spaces of pride, but in time also of death. The literary and erudite master is away but returns to inquire, and so Greer asks the profoundly feminist question, what dignity would labor provide in such circumstances? By looking at a variety of occupations and concepts of upward and downward mobility, Greer is able to negotiate with the unpleasant fact as to how the life of the arts is often seen to be dependent on shadow economies, such as the tavern and the whorehouse, themes dealt significantly over and over again by men in Shakespeare studies and institutionalized by those using Baudelaire as their excuse. Here, Greer looks at the home, the garden, the street, the shop, the church as viable locus of understanding town and country in medievalism. There is a great deal of poetry in the book, sonnets as well as plays, and Shakespeare's imagination goes hand in hand with a history of absconding from daily duties recreated in memory and in our practical understanding of a world long gone but still so present. So, Greasy Joan that keeled the pot, this is something that we have heard and read as young children. And Greasy Joan that keeled the pot is probably the most vivid description of women's lives as recorded in history. Yet when we look at Shakespeare's wife or Shakespeare's sister, Shakespeare's daughter, as Virginia Woolf would have us do in her room of one's own, we are set to ask a host of questions. The sonnets were written with both men and women in mind, the Earl of Southampton being the best known of patrons, and of course with Anne Hathaway and the Dark Woman. The Dark Woman could well have been a lute player. What we see in Shakespeare's time, the time immediately preceding this, is the shadow of how the state could be oppressive, executing people at will.
Around this, there would be a culture of poetry and protest, sometimes sublime and sometimes overt. Ratna Raman, personal conversation, suggests that George Herbert would articulate ideas of God and nature as being central to his reading of the politics of God. However, Watt, that is W-Y-A-T-T, also known as a silver poet, would use verse to castigate Anne Boleyn, who was once his lover, but now the vulnerable and yet powerful wearer of a crown. This paper seeks to read the poems of Shakespeare, Roland, and Wilde, essentially to ask, can we read the music that was published in Elizabeth's time as central around the political questions? Why did the publication of music cease? Was it because of Protestantism's denial of music, since it profoundly affected the senses? The mode would suggest that it was so. Books replaced during the Protestant wave in Elizabeth's time, the stained glass, the decorated churches and altars, and so that is why Kermode is focused on the fact of substitutions. It was in this age that the book became a familiar object with incalculable consequences. Since records are fairly thorough, it is known that between 1558 and 1579, 2,760 books were published. Between 1518 and 1603, the number rose to 4,370. John Guy calculates on the basis of an average print run of 1,250 copies that this represents an average of just two books per head of a population of 4.5 million over a generation and a half. Part of the endless bustle around St. Paul's must have been caused by the bookstores, for St. Paul's, in a sense, that social center of the city, was also the center of the book trade, and it was not far from where the newly arrived aspirant would find himself. The proportion of citizens who read may seem small, but there are enough of them to make bestsellers, one of which was Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis, an example of the Ovidian erotic mode which went into 9 editions in the poet's lifetime. One could go to St. Paul's and buy a sermon or a 6-penny quarter of a play or almost any other sort of book, from devotional tracts to romances. So this is Kermode, published 2005. School education was also very rigorous, and so the poet would have a fair grounding in rhetoric and in Latin. Theology was a subtext in all education, and Kermode wrote that the Geneva Bible, as one would expect, offered glosses animated by extreme Protestant conviction, and for the next 50 years it was the version most read in England. Interest in matters of theological interpretation, fostered by access to this primary source, were of spiritual importance, since they concerned the fate of the individual sinner, but they also encouraged close reading and understanding of linguistic subtleties. The subjects of all art, however, are its protagonists, and in Shakespeare's sonnets, which appear very much like religious songs in the Bible known as Psalms, there is an aura of bisexuality, often attributed to his love for his patron or his wife, or for the lute player in a tower. Whatever the nature of his fidelity to these great loves, they are nevertheless testimonies to great and fearless imagination. Germaine Greer, in a classic work, argues that Anne was a good representation of the verse in the Proverbs, and she quotes the proverb. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She seeth that her merchandise is good, her candle is not put out by night. She putteth her hands to the wheel and handles the spindle. Close quote. The important problem that Greer is raising for us is, how does a woman survive and see 3 children pass the plague, which in medieval times was hard to do? Anne was 67 years old when she died in 1623 on 6th August. She was thought to have been born in 1556. The house she was born in was called Hewland's Farm. Her family was a prosperous farming family. The oldest part of the house is from the late 14th century. It has a large hall where all the family members would have slept for warmth around a large oven, which still exists. It was a well-established family, and though Anne was 8 years older than Shakespeare, the marriage between them was an alliance of 2 substantial families living in a close-knit community. Greer argues that Shakespeare's mother was upwardly mobile, and that escape from the mother to an older woman's arms was not an unlikely event. She was the country girl, and Campion's Book of Airs describes just such a girl. Joan can call by name her cows and deck her windows with green boughs. She can read some Kitty's Lake and deck with plums of bridal cake. Is not Joan a housewife then? Judge true-hearted, honest men. Joan is of a lovely brown, nested any in the town, hair as black as any crow, and does nimbly trip and go. Happy is they are in time, who can give sweet Joan the wine? So this is a very common song, and we know that it returns to us as we see Joan the stir the pot. Clearly, as this poem describes young lovers, never mind age differences, age or temperament, as they attempted to seduce one another and the shock of the community when their temper and age did not match at all. Greer uses texts on the plays to prove the experiential quality of this differential love. He is very well favored and speaks very shrewishly. One would think his mother's milk was scarce out of him. The Reformation suggests that Anne might have been able to read. Women were encouraged to read and to teach children to read the Genevieve Bible. Greer writes that girls were taught to read and sew, knit and spin, boys to read, write and work with accounts. She quotes Nicholas Brown, who said in 1595, and I quote, "In the shops of artificers and cottages of poor husbandmen, you shall sooner see one of these new ballads, which are made only to keep them occupied, than any of the sounds, and may perceive them to be cunninger in singing the ones than the other." And indeed, the singing of ballads is very lately reviewed, so that every fair and market, almost you shall have one or two singing and selling of ballads. Maybe Will taught Anne to write, and consequently he wrote a poetry, the one skill he had manifested very early. One evidence is Sonnet 145. "Those lips that love's own hand did make, read for the song that said I hate. To me that languished for her sake, but when she saw my woeful state, straight in her heart did mercy come, chiding that tongue that ever sweet was used in giving gentle groan, and taught it true anew to breathe. I hate," she altered, "with an end that followed it as gentle day. That followed night who like a fiend from heaven to hell is thrown away. I hate from hate away she threw and saved my life, saying, not you." Anne was 8 years older than Shakespeare. She was independent, her father was dead, and she was unmarried. Above the age of 21, Greer argues that a woman was free and could marry when she chose. Anne was 26. She would have known how to milk and to make cheeses and to bake bread. She would have cooked, cleaned, swept the garden, washed clothes, raised cows, and she would have sung. Their family name was Gardner because there were so many Hathaways in Warwickshire. That there was no gossip about her and that she was not hounded out because of her relationship with Will Shakespeare is the actual location of Anne's identity, that Shakespeare loved her and knew her. Greer also argues that Lasslett's study shows that men and women married startlingly late in Elizabethan England, and the youthfulness of the husband, in contrast to his wife's age, was not unknown. In any case, he was dominated by his mother. Shakespeare had to deal in search of work very early. John Shakespeare, William's father, was greatly in debt. His mother was hugely influential in his life. She had been a favorite daughter, inheriting her father's valuable property over 7 older sisters. The custom was to favor the younger child. Mary Shakespeare's father, Robert Arden, had a large estate. She opted to marry a glover, who became an alderman, because the contrast between the artisans and the farmer's life was a contrast between town and country. She was a wealthy farmer's daughter who persuaded her husband perhaps to engage in the wool trade rather than the messy tanning trade of glove and animal hides. For a glover to deal in wool was illegal, since each trade had its boundaries by custom and birth. Yet, having been on many committees, in 1576, while his fortunes were fading, John Shakespeare applied for a coat of arms. Mary Shakespeare's property was mortgaged for £40 and it was lost. There was economic recession in the 1580s, and while they were in financial crisis, William impregnated Anne and married her. So there too was a dowry lost. Circumstances being what they were, it is not surprising that William needed a patron, and hence the bisexual nature of the sonnets, which on the whole were dedicated to his master, the Earl of Southampton. Anthony Burgess, in a book on Shakespeare called Nothing Like the Sun, is convinced that Shakespeare's absorption in tavern life was the cause of his terrible death. According to this version, Anne Hathaway is nagging him. So I'm quoting from the book it's a very beautiful book by Anthony Burgess, the same man who wrote the Clockwork Orange. So linguistically he's really approximating the world he's doing. I know not what money you earn. I know that you're seen smiling and silk with your fine friends, and I know that our things don't matter. Let me see. God knows I've had little nasty faith. What is it that you know? Oh, she turned away from him with a deep sigh. There are poems you have written. You have brought to Masterfield for his printing. That is old stuff, my poems. I brought home Lucrece, though none here would read it. Field himself told me that my father would read Venus, but he said it was 50 or some such thing. I said not that, but it is about naked goddesses. I, a naked goddess tumbling a boy in the field. She did not see that. She said, there are little poems, and some are to men, and some are of a black woman. She sniggled. Thou didst never write such to me. Sonnets? Is it sonnets? What is this for field being in that sonnet? There follows a terrible quarrel. She has one of those poems in her possession. W.S., frowning, puzzled, took up the poor little bound volume of devotional chatter, weak warnings of the Spanish Antichrist and the end of the world. He found a folded piece of good parchment, and even before unfolding, at once remembered the May night, his own trembling fingers, were they then now different fingers? Pulling from his breast what had been the towel, turns sour and rancid by the laughing reflection of a black-haired girl and the jeers of a new lover. How many years ago had that been? So I think the suggestion here that Anne herself might have been the woman of the sonnets, the dark lady. And here is a quote. My love be black, a beauty may not shine, and light so foiled to meet alone may turn. Heart is of my heart or earth is mine. Heaven do I scorn when in such hell I burn. Shakespeare's wife, according to Anthony Burgess' version, is adulteress with his brother, Matthew the lawyer. And Shakespeare returned to the black hall of the tavern, solicited and proud in her degradation. But then there is Sonnet 27. Weary with toil, I hasten to my bed, the dear repose of limbs with travel tired. But then begins a journey in my head, to work my mind when body's work expires. For then my thought, from far where I abide, intend a zealous pilgrimage to thee, and keep my drooping eyelids wide, looking on darkness which the blind will see, save that my soul's imaginary sight, presents thy shadow to my sightless view, which like a jewel hung in a ghastly night, makes black night beauteous and her old face blue. Lo, thus by day my limbs, my night, my mind, for thee and for myself, no quiet find. In Leslie, if I will say in Shakespeare, the sonnets are read as the embodiment of the appearance of the stranger within oneself and amongst others. In the end, we don't know who we are, nor do we know who the other is. And each day begins anew in mutual discovery or estrangement, love and death being the great puzzles of art and life. Caravaggio's book here is according to the text accompanying one of the pictures available on the web, an androgynous figure rather than like Shakespeare's Rosalind or Ganymede. The same theme has been picked up and elaborated in Shakespeare in Love. What should we believe but the transient nature of several stably fleeting loves and the immortality of the verse that describes these? While this chapter is concerned, this is from a book, so chapter 9 in a book called The Wisdom of Community, some years. What should we believe but the intransient nature of several stably fleeting loves and the immortality of the verse that describes these? While this chapter is concerned with violation in older forms, may well be in consonance with each other in medievalism, my interest remains with the notion of labor. Thank you.
you would agree with me that it's very fantastic and it's very exciting. Nice to the Bhutanit lady space in this space is Adam really top lady in the world. Yeah. But the mystery leads to many more issues, as you rightly said in the end, that's about the notion of labor. I think I shared with the audience at the beginning, and then the lecture will be in our discussion. The first point of departure in the lecture, in the book paper, I felt, as I was also reading it, and I told you, this idea of revisiting the legacy of inequality. And you very comfortably say that, you know, there is no harm in being inequality, trying to understand some of those materials which have been otherwise shelved in this whole anti-colonial drive to decolonize our cosmology, which is a very genuine drive, which is itself a legitimate politics of knowledge. But I really like this number, and this is particularly something which most of the post-colonial scholars need to understand, that materials which can be classified as Macaulayan material. Macaulay, and anybody who is aware of the politics of modern education would understand, it's Macaulay who comes and tells you what should be part of modern day education and what should not be part of modern education. So I really appreciate this intellectual confidence with which it is said that being Macaulayan, I can take interest in Shakespeare's material and I can make sense of some of those details, which helps us understand the ways we understand labor, love, debt, and so many other things. Largely, anthropology of emotion can be developed out of this kind of material. So that was something which I wanted to.
So I have shorter memory and I will answer these questions first. One, I will object to being called a Macaulayan because I think the whole project of translation has always represented itself in terms of this polylingualism, this heritage. So that is something which we really need to protect, and we must be able to do this wherever in the world we are. So I think Macaulayism represents for us as 1% of the population, which may have what is a certain facility arising from four generations of speaking language. So that is the space we occupy in terms of our historical past. So I would say that it's not something which I'm either ashamed of or proud of. It's the accent of birth that
I'm trying to celebrate it.
So yeah, so you don't say being a Macaulayan and not a Macaulayan.
Okay.
So the very sense in which you present this as a problem that we must think about, I will go it in two ways. One is the question of translation, and the other is the sociology of knowledge through culture studies, which allows us to be in any part of the world, in any part of the country, and be able to understand the other in terms of learning the language and the ideas which surround us. So I think that's the sociologist's message.
Fair enough. I was just trying to celebrate it. I'm going overboard with everything. Second was this particular regime of values in the world. You say Elizabethan values, a particular kind of encouragement, patronage for art and craft, and Shakespeare happens, and it is prolific in doing that regime of value orientation, which also seems to deliver a divide of home and tower, say for example. It's almost like Tagore's Ghare Baire in Shakespeare's world, right? So I was thinking whether one can, is there some possibility of deciphering some connection between South Asian Tagore's Ghare Baire, Elizabethan regime of values in which Shakespeare comes up with, has a biography which has a home with love and the tavern with love, home where labor of love is performed, tavern and outside world where labor of letters of Shakespeare is performed. And then in the middle of all of this, there is this strong influence of Protestantism which we gave birth to, Weberian understanding of Capitalism. So this mishmash of so many varieties of labor, some of Greg has pointed out, but I'm sure you will help us understand what exactly is the notion of labor in this wake of multiple varieties of labor being very prominent in this prism of values, labor of love, labor of letter, and labor that is defined by nascent capitalism under the influence of Protestantism. So these were a few things which I thought I should, other than that I have already pointed out all these things which, all those other things which may become very peripheral in our understanding of literature, art and culture, such as interface with politics, patronage, value orientation, historicity, biography of that particular time. That interface is very, very evident in the way you read Shakespeare's. But one ends with the same question: is Anne Hathaway really that dark lady in that sonnet?
So I think that when you compare Tagore's sense of being a universal poet, and he was acknowledged to be so, we have confirmation of this because in Henley Street there is a sculpture of Tagore in the background, and that has been put together by the influential Bengalis who were able to communicate that Tagore's legacy was important. So they must be very powerful. I'm always startled by the fact that in Shakespeare's garden, in the back garden, this sculpture exists. So that is really the way in which we know that colonialism was a byproduct of this transaction between countries. So the global imperialism that we are still subject to, the victims of which are peasants and tribals are still marked by. That is reread in terms of the sycophancy that we see Shakespeare himself being allegedly implicated in, to please the lord. So in some senses, whether it's a minor lord, whether it's a queen, so many ways in which we negotiate his success or the patronage that they offer him. All of these are part of what it means to stay alive. So I think staying alive is one of the most interesting concepts that emerge from this collage of many different meanings. So it takes about a year to put a paper together. And I would say while writing this paper, it was essentially in terms of just the questions of how we look at the parallel narratives that are set up. So every narrative allows us an engagement with something which happened 500 years ago, 400 years ago, in another country, in another continent. And yet we're able to see that there is a certain universality of being human. So that unity of the human mind, which is so much part of the sociology that we read as elders, so our generation was imbued with the possibility that yes, human rights exist, people can understand each other, learn each other's languages, live in different continents, and be at home in them. So I think that that's what you're referring to. And I'm sorry about that. Yes, about Anne, is she the dark lady? I would say that it's the idea of the shifter which linguists use and the self that, that Shakespeare represents is a way in which it constantly moves in relationship to his world. And the fictional aspects of it are well known, so there's a continuous curiosity about how he would have survived, what is the nature of his existence, and the premonition that this was made possible by the trust that his friends reposed in him, or the love that his family had for him. So in some senses, Burgess is actually working with the pettiness of conjugality, and yet that eternal circle within which human beings actually find themselves. So I think Shakespeare is being written about often, usually the context in which it rises now, is that anyone can sound like Shakespeare if they have the correct electronic algorithms. So the ways in which we define defining our ability to recognize a sonnet will depend also on our being human. So there is a very strange sense in which the problem returns to one. I mean, how do human beings write about love, and how would a machine write about love? So there is a cadence which arises from the nature of meaning systems itself. So this is what people are interested in. Whereas
earlier this presumption that another poet wrote the work or collaborated with the work. So for people like me who are working within a received tradition, I would say in my case a third generation tradition of reading Shakespeare in English, then the premise is that it's already placed in terms of a carryover of how mental language is being created. So, I'm a trader's granddaughter, I'm a pepper merchant's granddaughter. So whatever the nature of the poverty in which consequently we may find ourselves in as academics without jobs or struggling to find jobs, you know, these are biographical situations that we struggle with. And when we become old, we look back on those years of intense agility in terms of just writing a thesis and finishing a thesis. That's all we really remember. The poverty of students is a very non-factor, there's no doubt about it. You're in South Asian University, but when you start teaching in different universities in your own countries, that's what you have to attend to. How does an ordinary young woman or man actually access books, materials, computers, and so on. So I think when we go back to Anne Hathaway's comfort in a bourgeois context, and the home represents the same stability in my sense, but it is visually very powerful. The question that we ask is, what does this space of realism and the comforts of that realism, how does it affect her own perspective? And I think that's interesting. We are reading it in some detail, where she's looking at the property transactions and who's in charge. And that's fascinating, because we always say that women don't have power. But actually, when you look at it, when they're at home and in the comfort of their own context where they have a voice, if they have a voice, then whether it's expenditure, marriages, or what is to be bought in for how money is to be distributed, or let us say, even after the death of a parent, it's quite often the woman who may, in some senses, articulate a relationship of power. And that power as opposed to authority is what we are most concerned with. How does power work? So authority, of course, we're all rebellions, so we know what it means. But the real context of affectuality and of complacence and how do we deal with it is really different.
So,
we invite
questions from anyone in observations, questions. Yes.
I'm not neither student of sociology nor student of media. And what I used to say is that to me, and my lab to me always tires. The thing is that I came here when I was on Shakespeare and media. So I know Shakespeare at where I come. And my reading of fiction is started with Shakespeare. When you were presenting this was a very fantastic, nice presentation. Is really, I was immersed in the reading. The thing as I am going to ask you that, why you are choosing Shakespeare? Why not it? The low profile, local poet, that who talks about the skins in your life? Is it that the language? Or is it that he's a famous person? That's why you have taken him to celebrate his idea. What obstruct you not to take a local poet in this region? What is Shakespeare? As the Kenyan scholar Nubiwa Kemu said that, first give priority to your own language and then celebrate. So is it, and when we are doing work on Shakespeare and other English scholars, we are also prioritizing the English language and also inherently accepting the imperialism of English language. So what do you think?
Yeah, the fascinating question is finally we are placed in a particular location where people tell us what to do, right? And you are told what to do, you may or may not do it. The same way it is universally present that there is a copyright on how one thinks about freedom. So the freedom to exercise one's opinion or one's will or the choice that one makes is what I would fight to protect. That freedom is the ultimate freedom. So So whether there's a political space in which I'm located, and I'm saying that that political space is very, very complex. So I'm not out there, I'm not doing things to represent the way in which I stand for a particular ideology. So you might say that Dalit politics represents the questions of how the very orientation towards one's own locality is premised as a primary obligation. But the Dalits have also been known to define English as a commercial language, and they have proved that migration and translation is central to the way in which they understand the world. And they have deferred to a Dalit goddess as something which is significant to them. So I think these are policies, debates, issues. So now present government is saying Dalit, the word Dalit may not be used, but we must all use scheduled caste or scheduled tribe. So being a sociologist is true, I do use scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. I don't need the government to tell me that. And I do respect the Dalit movement and the voices that arise out of the movement. But I don't think I would in any context be subsumed by their movement, nor would I be subsumed by the communists, who would see the fiction I write as bourgeois fiction. So they would specifically say, why are you not working with the poor and the desperate conditions in which they live their lives? And I think that by documenting bourgeois lives, I'm saying a great deal about the poor. So I don't think that one can create these dramatic oppositions between the classes and communities in which we live and work. So I really appreciate what you're saying, because you know, that's where a lot of the criticism to my work comes from, whether it is fiction or whether it is sociology. And I'm saying, if there is a right to be a woman, I must have that right. So this sense that I must be either within separatist feminism or located within the context of how we define feminism, the history of feminism itself, I would say that my priority perhaps is to establish myself as a woman writer rather than a feminist writer. I might be labeled as a feminist writer, but I assert my identity and my right as a woman. Now this becomes problematic in many fronts. In fact, I had to run around the administration for 2 years before they would give me my letters addressed as Dear Sir, Bleak Madam. So 2 years I had to run around. I joined JNU in 97, and in 99 I got my first official letter and said Dear Sir, Bleak Madam. And they would say, matter longer tha, but maybe poocha nahi ki format badalna hai. So I said, that's fine. She was happy with receiving a letter which said, Dear Sir, that's her choice. But I don't want a letter which is addressed to me saying, Dear Sir. And I don't think I've won that battle. Because wherever we are as women who have succeeded, we're constantly understood to be successful because we are like men. So this is something which I've written about, and I think Joan Kelly is extremely interesting in terms of how she projects that issue itself in medievalism. I made a reference to that essay. Because many of the questions of how women are subjugated, not by their desire alone, but or by the desire of others, and the consensuality of this is represented back to you in terms of either feminine subjugation or feminine. I mean, it would either be subjugation or it would be agency. So I think that's what I'm really trying to handle conceptually in this paper. Can we think of agency only for dark women in time? So that's where the real representation is. Or can we also think of agency for the wife? So Germaine Greer, who's iconic for all her struggle, ends up writing a very sedate biography. So I'm not sure what is it that makes her write this biography. I'm startled by it, because this is not the reputation that she carries with her. And so I must presume that having found happiness in marriage, she returns to a space in which she quickly rustles up all the data that represents womanhood in one particular way, which is useful for us. I mean, as a sociologist, I'm interested in all these voices. I don't want to hierarchize them. I think the spaces that are set up are infinitely interesting, and I want to be able to respect that. I want to be able to negotiate with the sociologists with a variety of voices that are accessible to us, available to us, rather than fit myself into a space which we defined either by the publisher or by the Carnival gatherers, you know, because Carnivals in literature are so huge. So the basis of our own presentation of our materials can only be made by singular choice to do what we want to do rather than what the industry wants us to do. And I think millions of us who are in that space, not subjugating ourselves to multinational industry, whether it is publishing houses or whether it is festivals, because I think the voice of the writer, whether in terms of writing documentation or whether writing fiction, that has been left in a space of complete freedom, knowing that the objectivity of the one or the subjectivity of the other can be represented back in terms of their own responsibility to the form. So if, you know, the march of dominance occurs, I'm not very sure that the Dalits will be as liberating as they wish for their own communities to other people. So that hegemony of Dalit predominance, as for communists, as for the right wing, they have the agenda, and on the basis of their agenda, they create a language which becomes a dominant language depressing everybody else. I think it's for the writer to find a freedom which is located in terms of space and the dangerousness of that space. So the writer essentially is not afraid of anybody. Ideally, the writer, I'm saying the teacher is always looking to see that the students and themselves are in a space where they can define as having a survival.
No, just one line thing. I mean, I appreciate the idea of looking at the vicinity, the names coming from vicinity. But at times, it can also amount to identity politics based selection. It can become identity based incestuousness about the selection of things and names. So one should be slightly mindful of that possibility. Yes. Anything else? Any other questions?
But what he's talking about, the learning that young people have,
yes,
in terms of this, of the communities that they wish to represent. So I'm saying that yes, you have a right. But on the other hand, the person who doesn't want to fit within that circle also has a right. And the negotiations between them is what makes democracy possible. So that's what we have to fight.
No, what you said, I am agree with you. But the thing is, what you have said, I am agree with you. But the thing is that every literature work confined to Tagore. Why not other people?
Confined to
Tagore.
Yeah.
So we are like remembering him.
No, it doesn't happen in an unpredictable way. Like, there are ways in which we see sift out the background characters. My reading of Khorebari happened in a very different setup. And we were not idealizing a character that we posited as the central character. We looked at the other character and completely put on the verbal of image he was posited as the central character. So that is also the possibility. The fact is that a lot of these authors, they give you so many details that you can sift out the background characters, and that way you could come up with an alternate thing.
And choice is also about accidents. My father went out to buy a copy of Tagore. He never bought books. He was a communist and he believed that people should use libraries. But in the last years of his life, he died in 1963, he went to buy a copy of Tagore. He went in a bus, he put the money in his inner pocket. He used to wear those nail coats. I think Modi has designer coats, which he calls. But those people who lived in the poverty of the academic, they lived with the people. They caught buses, they shared the life of the people. At home, they drank lochu tea and, you know, bought fruit because the poor could not avoid it. So, So, I'm not saying that our life circumstances are the same. But my father went to buy this book and somebody stole the money from the inner pocket. And when he went to the shop, he didn't have the money. Unfortunately, he was a very cautious man who kept money in many different pockets. So, he could get home. But he bought what he could afford after having been stolen, which is a copy of Cape Gibran. Yes. So I'm talking about 1973. So Gibran opened up, he didn't expect by Gibran. Nor did we were not going to leave what our father had. Yes. So we were adolescents, we did what we wanted to do. So to be told to read a book doesn't mean that you will read that book. But reading Jadran accidentally was a very lovely moment, even for him. So I don't know why he went to buy Tagore. There must have been some reason, there must have been some representation of Tagore's work which interested him. So I think that when you think about the choices that you make or other people make, they have to be related to the context in which these choices are made, rather than the ideological world in which you're asked to make choices. Because the ideological bandwagon is so huge. You can come from anywhere, you can come from the right, from the left, from the conversation in our country, you can come from anywhere at all. And then you're forced to make the choices that are, you know, politically represented as the choice we make. We really have to ask why we are submitting to this forced choice. And we have to be, as social scientists, able to negotiate why writing becomes a space of our own representation or dissemination, and whether we will then be published if we think differently from how these large forces that are imposed on us as normal. Because every time the government changes, we are curious, how would that happen? So I presume you're happy with the talk.
Yes, yes, thank you very much.
Thank you for your kindness. So, I do enjoy coming to SLUs. Thank you.
Thank you.
From the reference of John Gordon,
John Doe.
John Doe. John
Doe. John Doe.
So,
yeah, so far. There are two images also.
Let me show you.
So very easy to find on a website, and even popular people have a copy. So the papers have been edited. So the group is clear. I mean, a lot of the ways in which we think about race, class, identity comes back in terms of how we think of the people who travel through Asian countries. So the sensibilities that are then present to you are really about, I'm not saying this is the root layer, but this is the root layer in a Tagore. So how do we look at identity itself? And why would we presume that the ability to think about race as a mixture of peoples, so the DNA test is what really makes us curious. The DNA test of people will surely pose on us soon to find out who are insiders and who are outsiders. There will be a history of mapping of trade routes, and a mixture that arises from these, whether it is trade or whether it is war. And the women will be implicated in many different ways. And my mentor, Liga Dubey, she used to say that if one wants to understand identity, then one really should be able to look at the ways in which we think of women as always being dasus. Wherever they are, they're always slaves. There's never any way that they may get out from being slaves. Now, our project as 21st century citizens is to provide rights and equal rights to women. So that's what we do, right, to the universities. So the assumption that you always return to a space where you think to be putting out your family becomes the only space in which you find ourselves. That's a long history. I have a paper called Women and Work, which is the EPW. You can have a look at it. I wrote it in 1992. And that looks at the ways in which this notion of housewifeization, or how women are being represented as enclosed within the house, is a result of capitalism. So it's capitalism that allows women to remain home at work. And from that very moment, they are then enslaved. So many of the questions that are posed in terms of history of work makes us understand that in the 21st century, we are really looking for the ways in which ideology can promote certain kinds of woman in us as opposed to others. So the BPO worker, for instance, she must have a clear voice, she must be concerned, she must be able to calm her client, she must be able to state accuracy what the figures are. And the spaces then are defined essentially in terms of what is required of her. So this emotional labor, which Dave was pointing out to, that is equally valuable when asks men what the nature of their obligations. So this involves in the house, so for your generation, the ability to share the work at home, so whether it's mothers, sisters, or in time, your wife or your daughter. Engaged in just the gentleness, it must represent the idea that they must not be afraid of it. Now that's a 21st century idea. It was not given in time that daughters should not fear their fathers. But the basis of our assumption here is that the closeness between father and daughter will then be translated in terms of the way in which she can go to the workspace, assured of her rights and her identities and her obligations, of course, and the privileges. If she does not know what her rights are, then how can she turn back to the family? So it's a terrifying world, I think, that living in the city of Delhi, you know what the city is going to be, as men and women. And so I'm just saying to the men that the work world can only be premised on the ability that men have to give women the freedom and also the spaces of protection and support. So a lot of feminist movements are actually dependent on the support of men. If men withdraw the support, then women are left in a situation of great terror and of psychological and emotional violence, which is experienced from both sides. So I think the representation then is that the rights of women are possible to keep society provides them that comfort. So that's for all of you who can become administrators, bureaucrats, lawyers, journalists, already are perhaps. So these are your obligations. The notion of being human is represented in terms of the solidarity that is created. So I think a lot of feminist debates have been about how younger sons are pressurized by their father and by older brothers. So the notion that feminism is only for women, redraw so very vivid writing of why we must be able to look at this space of interaction, of translation, and of understanding. So I think the social contract campaign is generally concerned with drawing out the details of the terms. That if we accept that to be human means to look after others as much as we care about our own safety, that's a space which has to be constantly talked about, written about, analyzed, because we don't see it around us and we are frightened by those ideologies which premise that male authority, male violence, male predatoriness is the norm. And I think that what we are saying is that there is a different world, a world which we recognize equally, and we should make it acceptable, because now it's a question of persuading others that that is what it means to be human. So when you look at Hannah Arendt's work, Human Condition, she's basically writing about just that. How do we negotiate the question of the everydayness? And the biographies written about her show that she escaped from the concentration camp on the way. The basis of finding her husband by chance. So it's a terrifying story, ways in which human life recognizes its vulnerability. And she says, let's go back to common sense. Let's think about common sense. So the basis of using common sense as the source of your own strength, that is what you need. Think about whatever philosophy may say that, or sociology may say that we should not depend on common sense. Whenever the danger of violence and normalization of the violence takes place, we know from day to day that we don't know if we'll see the end of the day or whether we'll see tomorrow.
So that's not a personal fear, it's a collective fear, something which everybody knows equally. Whichever party you belong to, so the right to belong to any party, that is your democratic right and you must keep it. But to actually engage in violence, that has to be understood as a case of illegality and of terror to those who are suppressed by this violence.
Thank you. So we wait for Peter.
But you want to listen to this, okay?
You want
to listen to this?
You want to say something?
Yeah, please. I have a curiosity and concern at the same time after the adopting of the government and the terrorists. And we have ample of things to do, but we have already a number of books like Ali Dasha, Vidya Sundar, Subrata.
Any picture was
like we have.
Pictures.
Yeah, I have curiosity as well as concern. Like after the Nepalese, we have ample of English literature at least in the academia right now. But we don't have the writings of Ali Dasha. Like he wrote the Vinyasa Bhutti on the flight of Shakuntala, and that will, there may be many takeaways from that writing, but we don't celebrate, like we don't have much of literature on those.
No, no, they are pretty literature.
But we are not taught like in the common.
No, we always talk in common.
Part is two thesis, interesting analysis of women's songs. But these songs are also drawn from the tradition which are present. So the oral tradition actually mimics a great deal of the tradition. So I think that's the space which you probably would like to extend as you mature. Because the terms of scholarship are that it takes 15 to 20 years to actually reach a space where you can produce a body of work. So I'm sure that what you're suggesting here will be your own reason to write. So that. But your space which you occupy, that's the reverent preoccupation of what is bias. And how does bias affect nature of our work? And must we acknowledge our bias? And yes, we have to acknowledge the space. So I'm saying I'm a Prepa Merchant's daughter from Kerala, and we had access to Hamlet in the 19th century. So the basis of that premise is a geographical one as well as a class location. So I'm saying, let's not apologize from where we came from. Let's be aware of what has happened in terms of violence of our own locations. But it's impossible for me to apologize for my predecessors as the Pope did for Nazi atrocities. I don't see it as missing. I see for myself. If people want to accuse me of having treated them unfairly or having, you know, recreated the space of domination and violence of my ancestors, let them do so. So that is the point that I'm making, that we are 21st century citizens in a free nation, guided by the constitution, with our judicial systems. And if we are implicated in violence in a contemporary situation, where we know that the terms of violence are so antithetical of what it means to be human, then we must essentially be able to state that. But we can't use caste background or gender background to nail people for what they are and what they are. So if they do that which is against the law and which we define in terms of human rights, the spaces are free. But should we use our parochialities in order to compare people to conform to what these parochialities are, in whichever country we live in, then we are part of a language which we know to be very, very common. We know it's happening all around us. And I would say that even if there is a small space that we allow for this dialogue between our different ideologies, if I'm saying that my secular ideology is being defined as shame in the nation abroad, so be it. That's for those who call it a block, for them to explain why they call secularism a block. I don't see it as a problem. I see it as the dialogue of religions which has allowed us to live in this country and in other countries. We have to take a statistic for how many Indians are living
any part of the world and what is the relationship of that country to them. So if you can work out the negotiation of survival for Indians in Australia or for Indians in Canada or for Indians in UK or America, if you can, or in Africa, if you can work out that relationship, what is the statistic of survival, then I would need to know why the statistics of survival for each of us in our own country would be dependent on the norms. So you're telling me it's problematic for Indians, for diaspora Indians. You're also telling me that these Indians who are now being marked out in streets, in shops, in cafes, they also are people who fuel the ABP, fuel the BHP. So the two have to be put in relationship to each other. So we can explain the funding that comes from these subjects which I'm naming through the Indian population there. We'll have some understanding as we go along of what is a right to life, what is a choice to life, and how may we live with each other in a country where each person believes they come from a different nation. So T.K. Oman's work, Ethnicity and Identity, is very important work because he is essentially marking out the ways in which the questions of assertion are part of how Indians must feel free to represent that assertion as a legal way by which they take into democracy. There's no solution to this problem. So first, you know, when we think of how the notion of Shakuntala returns to us in so many ways, and the film version, which is such an engaging representation of music, it's a very delightful way to think of our own re-entry into that point of literature and our own role in it through translation. Also the assumption that only those who will learn or speak or read or write a particular language will have access to the world. And that's what I'm arguing against. But the opening up of the boundaries or borders of language as much as of religion is essential to our quest to be free and independent wherever we are.
Alright, you want to
play
something?
What is happening around you in order to understand what is happening to you. So that's your job.